Namaste. Today, we are going to look into the concept of art, art appreciation, the basic philosophy of aesthetics through which Dr. Anandakumar Swami approached Indian art, in fact, world art. Here, we have to understand one specific thing, that is, why at all we should appreciate art? What is the importance? Is it for everyone or is it for some specialists? And does it not belong to the realm of past, the Indian art appreciation? The sculptures, you can see them in the museum. Perhaps they are more well-kept than they are kept in the temples. So what is the purpose of understanding this Indian art? Through darshana. Now for this, Dr. Anandakumar Swami gives a very beautiful reason, and that reason is that it is not only important for us, it is important for the entire humanity. He says, there was a time when Europe and Asia could and did actually understand each other very well. Asia has remained herself, but subsequent to the extroversion of European consciousness and its preoccupation with the surfaces, it has become more and more difficult for European minds to think in terms of unity, and therefore more difficult to understand the Asiatic point of view. By Asiatic point of view, he essentially means the Hindu and the Far Eastern Buddhist point of view. It is just possible that the mathematical development of modern science and certain corresponding tendencies in modern European art on the one hand, and the penetration of Asiatic thought and art into the Western environment on the other, may represent the possibility of a renewed rapprochement. Rapprochement essentially is the harmonious relations that are getting done. The peace and happiness of the world depend on this possibility. Now, we have to understand this aspect very clearly. Remember, Dr. Anandakumar Swami was talking when India was being colonized by the British, and they were positioning themselves as being on a civilizing mission. And here, Dr. Anandakumar Swami says that it is just possible that the mathematical development of modern science and certain corresponding tendencies in modern European art on the one hand, and the penetration of Asiatic thought and art into the Western environment on the other, it is almost like fertilizing the Western mind with the Eastern thought must be there if the world is to have peace and happiness. That is at one level. At another level, he says, even in India, we have a disconnect with the way we have to understand the art of India. So even in India, an understanding of the art of India has to be re-won. And for this, a veritable intellectual rectification is required. It is not to enlarge our collection of bric-a-brac that we ought to study ancient or foreign arts, but to enlarge our own consciousness of being. Here, Dr. Anandakumar Swami is very clear. He says that the Indians have to study art from a very Indic point of view, and they have to apply their framework not only to their ancient Indian art and the current art, but also to the foreign arts. And Dr. Anandakumar Swami indeed did this. He was able to create a framework, an Indian framework, through which he showed the West that they could appreciate their own heritage better and in a deeper and in a more holistic way than they do through their own frameworks. This is why the Indian art appreciation through Indian darshanas is important. Now we come to what is so great about the Indian art. So he says, Dr. Anandakumar Swami, that it is not a dogma, nor a book, but the great open secret that all knowledge and all truth are absolute and infinite, waiting not to be created, but to be found. So they have to be discovered. They have to be cognized. The secret of infinite superiority of intuition, the method of direct perception over the intellect. And the intellect here is regarded as a mere organ of discrimination. Now, this particular aspect of intuitive understanding, the method of direct perception over the intellect, that needs to be cultivated. The way of this access for this is not through intellectual activity, Dr. Anandakumar Swami says. The intuition that reaches to it, we call imagination and genius. So we have this treasure, he says, it is as yet unknown, infinite and inexhaustible. Now, the Indian art is something that reveals itself to each and every person and each and every generation, to each and every individual in its own way. So there is no such thing as this is a particular period art. And I have understood all the history of that particular art, all the social milieu that existed at that particular time, all the climate and everything. So I can understand that art. It is not like that. And because this is because here in the India and in everywhere else also, wherever there is the deep art is there. The art is religion. Religion is art. That is what Dr. Anandakumar Swami says in a paper, a very famous paper on a Christian mystic of 14th or 13th century, Meister Eckhart. In fact, he was condemned as a heretic. Even today, negotiations are going on with the Catholic Church, whether he is a current heretic or whether he could be again reinstated into the church and all that. But here, Dr. Anandakumar Swami actually applies the Hindu framework to understand this particular mystic, and he does that beautifully. Now, coming back. So we have here a division. And the Nehruvian education system, along with the Marxist tendencies inherent in it, has further deepened that divide. And what is the divide? You can look at a particular art as an institution and not as a worshipper. And the worshipper of a particular art form, which is sacred in India, in Indian context, is seen as a kind of inferior person. The aesthetician would come and he would talk about all the symbolism and he would talk about all the historical evolution of that particular image and all that. And then he would say that, oh, this worshipper doesn't understand all that. So he is a kind of an inferior person. Now, Dr. Anandakumar Swami points out this particular thing and he says, and here he makes a beautiful point. He says that this division that happens, particularly in an Indian, between the worshipper on the one hand and the aesthetician on the other, and then the aesthetician gains an upper hand, it is very similar to a formal desecration. So it is a formal desecration that happens at the psychological level. So it is like demolition of a temple inside you, which is even a greater loss. Just like how the invaders used to destroy our temples, our educational system now destroys the inner temples that we have, our inner sacred spaces. So he says, it is only by a change of point of view, psychologically equivalent to a formal desecration, that the worshipper who naturally regards the icon as a devotional utility comes to regard it as a mere work of art to be sensationally regarded as such. Then he says, of these two, who is more closer to the reality of that particular form? Of these two, the worshipper for whom the object was made is nearer to the root of the matter than the aesthetician who endeavors to isolate beauty from function. So now there is, particularly in the context of Tamil Nadu right now, when we are talking about freeing the temples from the mismanagement of acharansi, and that the devotees should have a say in matters of temple. A lot of intellectuals come in and they say, oh, these devotees are ignorant masses. They don't know anything about the temple. This temple architecture, the temple history, the social context in which the temple came, all that only the intellectuals we could explain. And we hence have a better right to the temples than these worshippers. Dr. Anandakumar Swami, as if he had expected this particular argument, he is giving an answer here, a very beautiful answer. And now we come to the art itself. We have to understand here that in India, the division between the secular and the sacred is not there. And it was Dr. Anandakumar Swami's achievement that he emphasized it in a very beautiful way, very clearly. And what does an art form actually do? The authority of Natya Shastra of Bharata. So in the Natya Shastra of Bharata, Brahma says to the Danavas, what actually this particular art does. And remember, Natya, when we say, Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami again points out, it at once means both the dance and the drama. So here, Brahma says to the Danavas that this particular art form, what it does? It yields the fruit of righteousness to those who follow the moral law. It yields pleasure to those who follow lust. It yields a restraint for the unruly. It yields a discipline for the followers of a rule. It creates vigor in the impotent. It creates zeal in the warriors, wisdom in the ignorant, learning in the scholars. And it offers sport to the kings, endurance to the sorrow smitten, profit to those who seek advantage, courage to the broken will. And then he says, that which is not to be found herein is not knowledge, nor craft, nor wisdom, nor art, nor deeds, nor yoga, the union. Now, here we have to understand very clearly that one act, one particular piece of art is viewed by different people with different needs, and it is able to fulfill all their needs in different ways. One can say that there is a pluralism in perception. So how this particular way of communicating, it is not made for this particular aspect. For example, your drama is not made to give pleasure for those who seek lust alone, then it becomes something else. It is not meant to create order in a particular society. It is not meant to give wisdom to the ignorant, but it does all that. Whoever comes with a particular need, that particular art form is able to provide them everything. And this is why the art forms in India are sacred, and this sacred secular binary does not exist here. Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami earlier, we know that Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami thinks that science can play a very important role in making the world understand Indian art and appreciate Indian art better. Let me just quote here two passages. Here is the first one. The Indian artist proposed to paint and actually painted what he saw. But this was not what we would have seen. He painted in the express likeness of what he saw, as if in a mirror, and yet not such a looking glass image as we see in the mirror. More profanely expressed, his work exhibited a characteristic distortion. We find, in fact, that the eyes are extended to meet the ears, no less in color than in word painting. Indian painting can be described at once from the Indian point of view as realistic and from our modern point of view as idealistic. Here, let us look at this passage again. Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami says, the Indian artist proposed to paint and actually painted what he saw, but this was not what we would have seen. He painted in the express likeness of what he saw, as if in a mirror, and yet not such a looking glass image as we see in the mirror. More profanely expressed, his work exhibited a characteristic distortion. We find, in fact, that the eyes are extended to meet the ears, no less in color than in word painting. So in color, he means the painting, and then in word painting, he means in work of literature. Indian painting can be described at once from the Indian point of view as realistic and from our modern point of view as idealistic. So this is passage from Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami. Now, let us come to another one passage. The purpose of art surely is not merely to depict or represent reality, for that can be accomplished very easily with a camera, but to enhance, transcend, or indeed even to distort reality. The word rasa appears repeatedly in Indian art manuals and has no literal translation. But roughly it means the very essence of. So a sculptor in India, for example, might try to portray the rasa of childhood or the rasa of romantic love or sexual ecstasy or feminine grace and perfection. The artist is striving in these images to strongly evoke a direct emotional response of a specific kind. In Western art, the discovery of non-representational abstract art had to wait the arrival of Picasso. If you are putting these two passages that I have quoted side by side, and if you attribute both to Dr. Anandakumaraswamy, everyone will accept that they were made by Anandakumaraswamy. In fact, the former one was made by Dr. Anandakumaraswamy. The later one was made by the famous brain scientist, Dr. V.S. Ramachandran. So when he is giving possible presence of certain neurological principles behind our aesthetics, he is giving this. Now, the question arises, in both of this, there is a basic fundamental substratum, and that substratum is rasa. In fact, the discovery of rasa that forms the basis of Indian art, Indian aesthetics. And it was formulated by Bharata, and later it was explained and it was even enhanced and enriched by Anandavardhana and Abhinava Gupta. And this forms the mainstream of Indian aesthetics, whatever may be the language, whatever may be the art form. And now we know that there are rasas, different type of rasas, but there is one rasa that is called as the Maharasa. It is the Santi rasa. Now, that Anandakumaraswamy points out one very interesting thing. In the first place, there is really a disturbance. In the second, there is the experience of a peace that cannot be described as an emotion, in the sense that fear and love and hate are emotions. It is for this reason that Indian rhetoricians have hesitated to reckon Santi or peace as a flavor, rasa, in one category with other flavors. However, the solution was this. Santi would be like an ocean out of which the other rasas would come out like bubbles. In fact, this brings to mind a very interesting parallel. And it was said by Mikio Kaku when he was explaining how to integrate the creation myth of Christianity, Genesis, with the Hindu Buddhist myth of creation, as he said, Hindu Buddhist myth of creation, and he said that modern science provides a solution, and it is this, that the Genesis, the creation in this linear time and that ends with the Armageddon, they are small bubbles that arise out of the ocean of Nirvana, the ocean of Brahman. So from the ocean of Brahman, these small things arise, small bubbles arise, and they fall back. The same way here, what we are doing here is that the Indian aestheticians, what they did was that they made Santi the Maharasa, out of which the beautiful bubbles, splendidly colored, the love, hate, everything, they arise. And once they arise, they again fall back into rasa. That is the purpose of the entire, ultimately, whatever art form we are creating and whatever emotion it may evoke first, ultimately, all have to be harmonized in the Santi rasa. And when we are doing that, it almost becomes a form of a sacred ritual. This rasa forms the basis. And coming to the distortion, the purpose of distortion then is, of course, as Dr. Anandakumaraswamy says, the concept of distortion is a profane word, but nevertheless, we can use it because both Dr. Anandakumaraswamy has used it and Dr. V.S. Ramachandran has also used it. So how you do the distortion? In the case of a cartoon, the distortions are done to the face of people with the purpose of creating a particular feeling towards that person. either you should like that person or you should hate that person or you should look at him with a kind of feeling of awesomeness or a kind of aversion. So that is how the distortions are created. In the case of Indian art, how these so-called distortions are created? They are created, as we saw, to create the Santi Rasa. The distortion that Dr. V.S. Ramachandran speaks about is rooted in a concept called a kind of a phase shift. For example, if you are having some rats and you are training the rats to choose rectangles over squares. Choose rectangles over squares. Now, what happens? Later, the particular rats, they start choosing not that particular rectangle, but the form of the rectangle. So, more that particular rectangle that you are presenting is rectangular. For example, you have a rectangle with the 3 centimeters and 4 centimeters, and you have another rectangle with the 2 centimeters and 6 centimeters. The rats would prefer the rectangle with the 2 centimeters and 6 centimeters because they are now tuned to perceive that which is more rectangular. Now let us apply the same thing here. All the emotions, let us say all the rasas. Now if you are applying the same principle here, now let us look at this. All the rasas, they have as their basis the Santi Rasa. So whatever rasa you may be presenting, the person who receives it should be able to feel the Santi Rasa deep inside it. A person may love to get horrified by seeing horror movies, or a person may love to have Shrinkar Rasa in a particular literary form or art form. Whatever it may be, ultimately, he should be moved towards the Santi Rasa. And to do this, the distortion has been done. The distortion is then done not just to create a feeling of, let us say, sensual feeling, or to create a kind of feeling of valor, deep inside the valor, deep inside the supernatural or even frightening aspects, you have Santi Rasa. That is why you look at the form of Kali. An Indian does not feel frightened. An Indian feels a deep sense of peace, bliss, because the form, despite the strong Rudra form, the very strong outwardly frightening form, inside there is a motherliness. And our mind is tuned to feel that motherliness. The person who created that image, the person who created that particular sculpture or the painting or the word form, the litany or whatever, he also was able to communicate it through that particular form that he has created. And how does this process happen? That we will look into. So, the beginning. Dr. Anandakumar Swami points out this. That there is a contemplative vision. You have to become an expert in contemplative vision, yoga dhyana, for which there are canonical prescriptions. You go through all this and you become an expert in contemplative vision. And it is not done by direct observation. Pratyaksha, that kind of observation is considered as somewhat lower than this. So, we actually, in Indian tradition, between Sindhayet Pramanam and Pratyaksha Pramanam, the Sindhayet Pramanam is more important. Pratyaksha, the empirical observation or reflex registration, as we say, it is considered as aiding the previous one, the contemplative vision. It should aid the contemplative vision. And between these two, it is the image that is got from the contemplative vision that is important. The whole procedure may be summed up. Now, this is Dr. Anandakumar Swami. The whole procedure may be summed up in the words, when the visualization has, or when the model has been conceived, set down on the wall, what was visualized. Then he gives a very interesting instance from Indian culture and tradition. The distinction and sequence of the two acts had long since been recognized in connection with the sacrificial karma of the edification of the fire altar, where whenever the builders are at a loss, they are told to contemplate, direct the will towards the structure. And it is because they saw them contemplatively that the structures are so called. The structures are called as the yak because they are seen through contemplation, through this contemplative vision. So this is the first basis. Then worship is paid to that image that is mentally conceived. This is the process. The worship is paid to the image that is mentally conceived. True knowledge of an object is not obtained by mere empirical observations or reflex registration, but only when the knower and known, seer and seen, meet in an act of transcending distinction. The process is this. In the words of Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami, worship is paid to the image that is mentally conceived. True knowledge of an object is not obtained merely by mere empirical observation, but only when the knower and the known, seer and the seen, meet in an act of transcending distinction. So this aspect is important. Only when you are in such an union of anayo advaita that you will be able to start the creation. So what happens here? Your mind or whatever your inner being becomes like a kind of clean mirror to which the reality of the thing that you are looking at, that gets reflected. And it is this reflection that is taken and then it is created. So for the Indian sculptor, or for that matter, every Indian artisan, the work is also an art because the work is also religion. In fact, there is a famous saying in Tamil that Cheyyum Tholile Devam. Essentially, it means what you do is your God. So here it is not an empirical superlative saying of or hyperbole of considering work as something very important as equal to God. Essentially, it is all work permeated by divinity. All work, whatever work that you are doing, it is permeated by divinity. So now, the procedure on the part of the imager above outlined implies a real understanding of the psychology of aesthetic intuition, Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami says. To generalize, whatever object may be the artist's chosen or appointed theme becomes for the time being the single object of his attention and devotion. And only when the theme has thus become for him an immediate experience can it be stated authoritatively from knowledge. So it is after this understanding of the knowledge, the theme, that he sets forth to work it out and it comes out beautifully. And the amount of the feeling, the experience of beauty that you get from that particular art form is actually a testimony to how much that creator of that particular form has been able to tune himself with or has reflected the real nature of the art that he is creating in his own inner being. Here, Dr. Ananda Kumar Swami gives a very interesting instance. He quotes Adi Shankaracharya as saying that he learned the art of giving complete attention from an arrow maker. So the arrow maker was so immersed, totally he was attentive to the work that he was doing. And from him, Shankaracharya learned the art of giving attention. This is very important because here what happens is all artisans become yogis when they are doing their work. There is this art of yoga permeates all Indian existence, whether you are a weaver, whether you are a painter, whether you are a classic musician, whether you are a dancer, doesn't matter. In everything, the resort. So a carpenter, that Ananda Kumar Swami gives this example, that a carpenter then is not lower to, let us say, an orator. There is no distinction in principle of orator from carpenter, but only a distinction of things well and truly made from things not so made, and of what is beautiful from what is ugly in terms of formality and informality. So here there is no such thing as a higher art form and a lower art form. So a carpenter who is doing his work very beautifully, who is united in his being with what he is creating, is definitely superior to a musician who kills the soul of that music and only adheres to the form and markets himself in international arena. All this may look like theory. Is there really a reality to it? Here we have bulla carts. Still we have wooden bulla carts. And when we were children, we would be running behind these bulla carts and we would be hanging in it, because if the cart driver, bulla cart driver sees us hanging, he would be shouting. So we would be going inside and there were two small iron rings and we would be hanging on it. There, we have observed in the beam that connects the two wheels, you have beautiful carved mandala pictures. You cannot see it at all. You cannot see it at all. Unless otherwise you are going there and you are stealthily hanging there as a small child. So why should a carpenter who is creating just ordinary bulla carts, so-called ordinary bulla carts, should take his time and carve something so beautiful in a place where nobody would see that? What is it that prompts him to do it? What is it that makes him do it? It is this culture that makes him do it, of course. Because if you look at all the old bulla carts, you will find that in the beam, the connecting beam, there is a beautiful mandala carved. So when I asked about this to a historian of our particular place, our district, he said, it's no big deal. It is because when they go to the markets, you know, or when they are going for races and all that, they have to identify their bulla cart. So they have made this distinct marks. In fact, if you look at two bulla carts with the carvings, you will find that they look almost the same, but they are different. They are distinct. But if you want it as just a form of identification, you can just carve the name. You can have a small family logo, or you can just put a number, whatever. Why go into this intricate form and do it? So this is where we have moved away from our history, our art appreciation, our view of looking at our culture and our society. So he is just a mere carpenter. What does he know? What does he know? He is doing it because there should be some mundane reason. There cannot be some sacred reason. Actually, this is sacred for him. Creating this is sacred. And the same is true for a weaver. The same is true for a person who is plowing his field. Everything in India is simultaneously an art, simultaneously a worship. When we understand this, then again, and this is very important, because that Ananda Kumar Swami says that this is universal. This instinct to seek the sacred is universal. The words of Albert Einstein, all good art and all good science comes from a cosmic religious feeling, with a capital R for religious feeling. And this is universal, of course. And whatever may be an art, whatever may be the country, whatever may be the religion, whatever may be the race, in a very good true art, you can identify this sacredness. You can identify this sacredness, but it is only in India that it has been recognized, that it has been given a form. It has been, one can say, democratized to the last person in India. Everyone, whether you are a big, great musician or whether you are a very so-called ordinary carpenter, this feeling of sacredness in your craft is there. And it is this feeling of sacredness in your craft that actually creates, when it reaches a critical mass inside you, the real art. So, understanding Dr. Anandakumar Swami's concept of art can also lead us to understand our own society, all its levels, and also help us to play our civilizational role in the Committee of Nations. Thank you so much.